Luke's gone off to have a haircut. Oh,
No, I'm here.
hiya!
Haircut's
What
done.
a lovely haircut you've got there. That's wonderful.
Haircut's done.
Okay, we are.
Stop now.
What? That's no, just starting.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. Yeah?
Yeah, it's
Yeah?
fine.
You alright? You know
Yeah,
where
let's
you
do
are?
it.
Do you know where you are?
I didn't want to ramble on that.
Are you okay?
I do. I'm
Are you
here.
feeling alright? You didn't want to ramble. Now
I
you're
didn't want
here.
to ramble, but I'm here. I'm
Why not?
in.
Why didn't you want to ramble on that?
I'm in. Right, yeah, welcome. We are. This is episode
31, is it?
31 overall. For you Anchor listeners, this will be episode 3. We've only done three. This is the third one on Anchor. So if you do want to watch us ramble in the past, head over to the Facebook Ramble Facebook page.
Previous rambles, yeah.
Yeah, head over to the FIFA Ramble Facebook page, and you will see some previous rambles on there, and you'll be able to watch us in glorious Technicolor.
What a treat that is.
What a treat that is.
What a treat.
So yeah, big week, isn't it?
That's been all right.
It's there's been a lot going on.
Lots of things, lots of things to
Awful
do.
lot going on. So yeah, let's start as we always do on this one, because I have to do a little bit of admin, as I always need to do at
All
this
of the
time.
admin. So we got a couple of little rambles heading your way. Basically, all centered quite a lot around Man United this week.
Yeah, it's
We're
quite a bit. It's
gonna give
United
Arsenal a rest.
centric.
There'll be a little Arsene Wenger loving, which we're gonna do. Because
Don't give
guess
the
what
game away.
we've got quite a few Arsenal fans
We got quite a
on
few.
our.
Yeah, we got quite a lot of Arsenal fans who listen in. So, you know, shout out to our
Which is blooming marvellous.
Arsenal fans involved. But this week, the question, it's not really a question. Someone put, there was an article posted on a very good United website. It's called United in Focus. And it was an article written by a very, very good writer who I do urge you all to check out, called Wayne Barton. He's written a lot of United books, including his latest is the Jimmy Murphy biography. The Jimmy Murphy, just to indulge myself a little bit on this because it's very good.
Go
Jimmy
for it.
Murphy was Matt Busby's assistant manager, but he did a lot more than that. He was manager of the youth team, so he brought through, you know, your Bobby Charlton, Duncan Edwards, Nobby Styles, the team that won the European Cup in '68, basically. And prior to that, obviously with the Busby Babes. He was also the man that was left in charge following the Munich air disaster. He did a lot for the club. He kept that the ship sailing through extremely stormy waters which I hope no other football club ever has to go through again. It's a very, very good read, and it was the number one selling book, football book or sports book on Amazon upon release. It's been extreme. It's very,
Is
very
that one of
good.
your top books?
Yeah, I cannot recommend it highly enough. He's a very, very good writer, and he's an extremely good man. He wrote an article, and the title of it was, "It is not the responsibility of the supporters of Manchester United to lower their expectations. It's the responsibility of the manager to live up to them." And I just wanted to get some opinions on that, really. Because United fans have got an extremely high expectation because they have seen them be extremely successful. I always think of the James lyric when I think of my club the last few years. If I hadn't seen such riches, I could live with being poor. And it's sorry, I've watched.
What philosopher was that?
Yeah, well, I've watched my. That's what I always think.
We'll delve a little bit into the mentality of Man United and the Mourinho era of red,
Yeah.
which is seeping in. So yeah, we'll go through that. I know you can wax all lyrical all evening,
I
couldn't
could
you?
literally do an
Couldn't you?
entire podcast just
So
based
sort of
on.
do every week.
Well,
Well.
United get talked
We'll
about, but they are the biggest club in the
discuss that
world,
later.
so.
No one gives them any nonsense, though. We got a Jane Smalley in. Jane, hello. There'll be no swearing this evening because we've got this little chap. If you remember, he is Mr. Waffle
For you
Sprucklesworth.
anchor listeners, I mean, this very visual section of
It
the
is a
podcast is going to
visual
be
section.
is going to be great for you people listening just in audio.
Basically, anchorers, there'll be no swearing at this particular point.
I
Big
have a
up.
7-year-old daughter who was told us not to swear.
Yeah, and I've
listen.
got Luke's mum telling me not to swear, so I am not going to swear.
No.
Dag nab it. Yeah, don't sarn it. We're not going to go there. We're not going to do it.
Sakatash and all that.
Big up to all of our new followers. We appreciate it, especially on Anchor. Anchor's a cool little.
Yeah,
little
Anchor's been really good. But yeah, bigger is honestly we've. Let's indulge ourselves now again.
We don't have to. No, let's.
We've been.
Let's move on.
A lot of good feedback, and it's very much appreciated.
It is indeed. Across the board, but yeah, we're just trying a couple of things. We're over the span of these next couple of weeks, we are gonna try our damnedest to up the quality of what we're putting out. Probably not content, because it's just, you know what to expect from us now.
No, the quality.
We are
be...
fully aware. It's just a lovely little ramble is what we've got going on. A jolly romp, someone's described it as.
A jolly romp indeed.
Highly jolly romp. But yeah, big up Kwame. Listening, that's all good, bro. He's a new joiner of ours. That's pretty sweet. He sent us some good stuff, especially on the anchor vibe. So that's pretty damn cool. We are aware there's football going on this evening as well, and Chelsea are 1-0 down thanks to none other than. Have you heard of this player? He's called
Leo Messi.
You ever heard of him?
It's an interesting one.
Yeah, so it's him, and one called
one to look out for.
I think he was called Luis Suarez.
Luis Suarez.
You ever
yeah.
heard of him? Because he's I hear he's pretty good. I hear they're pretty good.
It's pretty good.
And it's a team called Barcelona, and they're from Spain.
They are.
And I hear they're quite good as well. And they are beating Chelsea at the moment.
Talking about Barcelona, Alexis Sanchez.
Sanchmo. The Sanch. Should we give it a once over? 1-2-1-2-1-2-1-2.
Fine. Sanchez
is
gonna have his best game.
Not his best game in Sevilla. Do you think he's trying too hard?
I do think it's difficult for me to say it because obviously he's
trying to be the bus driver of the Buster's Park.
Yeah, he did seem to try a lot. Last night he tried way too hard, and what he was trying, he wasn't coming off. But I do think that there's an element of people won't do it because he's been paid a lot of money.
How long
will
they give him
he does need time to fit into that team. Let's not forget that this is the same footballing public who wrote off David De Gea. That's all I'll say. And I know he was younger, but De Gea was. There was talk that they should play Anders Lindegaard over De Gea because we signed them both at the same
Thomas
time.
Kuzcek.
Yeah, we signed Lindegaard at the same time. Our three goalkeepers were De Gea,
Lindegaard was
Kuzcek,
just a weird character.
And Lindegaard.
You ever heard him talk and his humour?
I think
he was a good enough keeper technically, but I just don't think he had the character to win people over really.
No, he was. But they were both signed at the same time.
Yeah, that's interesting about the goalkeepers. But Di Maria. Was given well. He had a great start to his career.
He had a brilliant
but
start.
Then it doesn't take long for people to just peck away, and I'm just wondering how long Sanchez actually got until that happens. Until people start turning on him, I wonder if he'll pick up, right? And he's always going to be useful on the pitch. Don't get me wrong, but I want to know the time scale people are going to start to sort of turn and sway and turn on him if this type of performance continues. Which is harsh because he tries his damnedest, and that's what you pay the money for.
Yeah, he is trying. It's just going to take time.
You need little time.
It literally is just going to take time with him.
Because there's nothing that's gelled and meshed or clicked just yet.
It's a new team, a new set of teammates.
What's he got? He did a penalty, didn't he? Which got saved, then he smacked it in, and he did a couple of assists. Am I right there? Is he
yep.
doing anything? Basically, that's all the. From a showreel, apart from trying his hardest, that's the stats to his name, right?
That's about it.
But he did lose the ball a hell of a lot against a Sevilla team, which are is a very strong team. That is a very, very tight unit that Sevilla have got through the entire team. And for people to say, you know, we heard people writing off Sevilla. Before in the first game in the 0-0.
Yeah, there was a lot of writing them off, wasn't there? just didn't.
If you're a football fan, you are aware of how successful Sevilla have been in European competitions the last, what, several years? Consistently.
Yeah, well, they've won the Europa League.
Back
what
to
was
back,
it, 3 years?
3 years in a row.
3 years on the trot they won it.
Yeah.
But they won it back last night, didn't they? Because they beat the holders.
Yeah.
Didn't they?
Then
is
that's
that what
how
it
works,
was?
Yeah.
Is
play,
that,
play
is
the
that
winner.
What it was, do you reckon?
Winner take all.
Sevilla just thought, you had our trophy last
yeah.
year. That was ours. And now they've, you know, I just hope they got checked when they were leaving the stadium.
Hmm. First half of that game.
Yeah.
Against Sevilla. There was again, we used to talk about it all the time, a lack of penetration.
There was. A lack
I
of
couldn't
penetration
see any.
Will always end in tears.
I wanted to see it, and I couldn't see it.
No, I couldn't see
I
any
could
penetration.
I could not see anything. I was really hoping for it as well. I couldn't see it.
I think everyone was longing for penetration.
I think we always do.
United looked like a team that were defending a lead, but they'd forgotten that they didn't have one.
Yeah.
They afforded Sevilla so much space in and around the box, and they were hanging off them. They were saying, now, it just was, I couldn't work out what they were trying to do. And it looked like a game where you needed someone who was going to get the ball in midfield.
You need a hero. You're holding out for a hero.
They needed someone in midfield
who
was going to grab the game by the
Sanchez
scruff of the neck.
Is what you need,
well, what,
which he did try, but it just didn't penetrate it enough.
I think that game last night needed more like Roy Keane versus Juventus in 99. Who was going to just grab the game, and he was going to pull everyone with him, whether they wanted to come with him or not. And he's going to drag them through. Now, the problem is that we have players at the club who are able to do that, but I don't want to play the blame game here.
It sounds like you're playing the blame game.
Well, I'm gonna have to because
you don't want to.
There's two off the top of my head who have the ability to do that straight away in a central midfield role. One of them is Ander Herrera, who was, you know, out, but the other one is Paul Pogba, and Paul Pogba has the ability to do that. The only issue that Paul Pogba has is that he's not playing in the position that he needs to be playing in.
Was this
and he's
a carry-on of the nonsense of McTierney, of injuring him in the last minute of the game? Is there anything to that, do you think? Because he seemed pretty sparky after the Liverpool game,
yeah.
High-fiving Jurgen and Mourinho during the interview stage, live.
Yeah, no, well...
And then how long was he given last night?
Not long.
15 minutes?
Yeah. It's... I genuinely don't think that he was fit. I don't think there's as big of an issue with Pogba and Mourinho as people are making out, because they seem to have a very good relationship. But...
Stupid thing to interrupt a live interview, though, wouldn't it?
Well, yeah. He's
a lad. He's a lad.
He's a lad. He's a lad. We talked... We talked about this when they first signed Paul Pogba, and we said, "Where's the Pirlo? You know, in that midfield three, where's the Andrea Pirlo?" And it could still be Carrick, but I just think Paul Pogba is being asked to play the Pirlo role, whereas quite blatantly, he's more suited to playing the Paul Pogba role.
Yeah,
but that's
why McTominay's in, right? Do you think?
Potentially.
I'm not. Tottenham is the next Pirlo. I'm just thinking it's a structure for him to work with and manoeuvre around that, you know?
Yeah, potentially. We just need to keep an eye on that. Yeah.
But yeah, I'm just... it was a weird one to see that. But you have to give credit to Sevilla. No one will, because that's not how things work.
No, Sevilla played very well.
So Mourinho's... What are they going to say? They're ripping him over the park the bus tactics and the boring nature and not getting a result, which is not against...
It doesn't happen, does it? Sometimes you just don't get the result. Sometimes it's that simple. That's how football works.
Yeah. I didn't see him in the interview stage after it. How was it, what was his mindset like? Because I just watched the game.
He said, I'll paraphrase it because I don't know the direct quote. He did actually say, and this is the one thing that I did take sort of umbrage at. Really, he said, "I've been here before as Porto manager. I've been here before as." Real Madrid manager, getting knocked out of the Champions League in the last 16 stage is nothing new to Manchester United.
Mic drop out.
Yeah, I mean, that is literally a man saying, well, don't blame me it's happened before and I wasn't here before. It's like, yeah, but you're here now. You're here now. You've got to take responsibility for the fact that you went out, you selected the team and you told them to play a certain way. And the way that you told them to play initially was to stand off Sevilla. That is down to him.
And it's all part of the cult of Mourinho, that, though, isn't it? It's a bit of deflectiveness.
No, it was the worst deflection I've ever seen, because he was literally saying, you've been here before, it's nothing new, it's not because of me. He said, look, my players tried their best and I tried my best and it wasn't good enough. Well, no, you just got it wrong. It's not the worst thing in the world. A football team lost a football match. It'll happen again tonight.
And it's at a very high level.
It's extremely high level.
And it's the first time that Man United have been in that position for quite some time.
It's just
in the Champions League.
It just happens. It's just games get lost. It's not one to, you know, worry about for too long.
So earlier we discussed in the mindset of, like you said, like the high expectation of what the Man United and Arsenal fans have on where their club should be.
Yeah, there is a big, there's a much higher level of expectation.
And we put that against what happened last Thursday, which I was in a pub watching the Spurs game, and Spurs go down. Spurs got absolutely schooled by professionalism of Juve. The
Chiellini
way they played,
did the
right team. Yeah, they did exactly what they needed to get what with like a massive amount of experience and just grit and determination, and just they never quit, they never stopped.
No.
At Wembley, that was huge. Allegri just absolutely smashed it in the second half.
Yeah.
And that's what happens as well when you've got high profile, super sufficient strikers.
Mm-hmm.
Who can finish the job with a chance, with like not even, it was like a half, like those two were half chance, they were superbly taking goals.
They
both
were really, it was good, it was really good.
Higuain, back to our old favourite, Higuain.
Yeah, Juve won tonight, they've already played their game against Besiktas, and
yep.
They won 3-1, I believe it was.
Who? It was Munich, wasn't it?
Oh yeah, sorry.
Bayern München.
I'm getting Juve beat Atalanta 2-0. Sorry,
yeah.
I'm getting confused.
You alright?
I am.
Yeah.
I think I've taken a knock to the head talking down that wall.
So I think they got outclassed and outgunned by a ruthless Juve team who were away, and they just did a job, and that's what they do because they're consistently now on that level.
Yeah.
And last year they were finalists. You know, they're flying. They're on top. They're peak, aren't they?
Yeah,
they are above and beyond. And Allegri is such an interesting character.
He is.
Beyond the football, he seems so fascinating. I'd quite like to have a beer with him, actually.
Well, he's been linked with PSG.
Yeah, understandably.
Conte is favourite.
Conte is. I want Conte to be happy and get some vigour again, you know?
Yeah, Conte's favourite. But you can see a scenario where, you know, there's going to be a changing of the guard at a couple of clubs this summer.
Totally. There's big names, but like if we're comparing and contrasting Mourinho, Wenger to Poch this year, like I saw that there was that anger, that deep seated anger when I saw a pub full of Spurs fans after announcers bottling it after taking the lead in this, that and the other.
Yeah.
I don't think they could have tried too much harder. I don't think the tactics were that bad. I just think they got absolutely schooled by
team. It's just what happened is one set of managers got his tactics right
either.
In the second half.
Yeah.
And they just got outthought and outplayed based on tactics. Pochettino didn't react to it quick enough and they conceded very quickly.
Yeah.
But again, that happens.
And it brings into question, like we were saying earlier, about to what scale, how do you measure the success and what that brings in terms of, like, Poch, he's a fantastic, phenomenal guy, great coach, great manager, very tactically aware, never switches us, has this hunger for the game so much.
Mm-hmm.
We've got this really progressive Spurs team, but guess what, no wins for quite some time now, and you're going to expect to keep Harry Kane and, like, the England squad of that whole team together, and it's a tricky thing because once people get on your back, he can go anywhere he wants. I like him because he is still very positive in his approach and his outlook and believes in what he's doing. I don't know how much further he can push Spurs.
Well, the
and
problem,
I think he's very high profile.
The thing with Spurs this season for me is what you said there was key. You know, it's a very progressive squad. Now I do agree. I agree it is. However, they've regressed this season.
Yeah.
They've last season they got enough points to win the league if Chelsea hadn't have.
I remember sitting here talking,
a very good year.
Talking about their.
We all said Spurs would finish outside the top four.
So, yeah, some of us. Yeah.
Yeah, some of us actually. You said Spurs.
I couldn't actually see it because their transfer policy, when we were hooning and harring, when you were crying over Man United getting a defensive midfielder in.
I was just trying to. Yeah, I'm just.
And Arsenal fans were crying out for something, anything, give us anything, because it was all dire and everything was worse than it was. So it's just interesting how things are measured. And you said Man United Arsenal are a very high profile club, and you said they were bigger than Spurs.
Yeah.
Yeah, so there's more expectation on them rather than Spurs. I don't see how people can give Arsenal and Man United, but Arsenal like predominantly, such a going over on one hand, and then Spurs, who have like nothing to their name really, if it comes down to purely success and purely cups, and nothing on the other. That only goes so far. I think Poch is doing wonders there, but I don't understand how it's quantifiable to the Arsenal setup in itself.
Yeah, I don't. And the thing with Spurs is that's going to become a catchphrase. Robbie Savage said this week in with Pochettino, he said in BT Sport, he said that Pochettino was being talked as the next Real Madrid manager. And everyone is praising how well Spurs have played this season and what great football they're playing. Mm. Everyone has criticised Mourinho's tactics, how he makes Man United play football, calling him negative and saying Man United haven't been enjoyable to watch and aren't a good football team. Now, Spurs are 7 points behind Man United, and Man United have scored more goals than Spurs, and that was Robbie Savage's point. And I think it does come down to the fact that Manchester United are held to a higher level of expectation based on success. At the minute, Spurs are benefiting. Maybe benefiting is too strong of a word, but they're benefiting from their lack of success trophy-wise. They haven't won anything. Spurs are at a level, and have been for a while, where top four is a success. That is their success. Now, you can only have that class of success for a certain amount of time. There is going to be a sell-by date.
There's
and that brings you back to Arsenal.
And football in general.
Yeah, but Arsenal always, it was the whole thing of, and Arsenal won the top four trophy. Now, they've fallen out of that. And now the media have spun it, and not just the media, but football fans in general who aren't Arsenal fans, and some
Arsenal
fans on Arsenal Fan TV. But they've spun it in that, we need to win top four. Well, okay, well, you just had over decade-long of reaching the top four, and they were mocked because it was seen as, oh,
that's
you see that as a trophy. Now they're out of the top four, and suddenly people are realising how damn hard it is to finish in the top four consistently for that length of time, and it's, you don't know what you got till it's gone.
Look, and that's why I said
but
last
Spurs
week.
Spurs don't have that, but they will have. Spurs have only got a certain amount of time
yeah.
with Pochettino being classed as it's Emperor's
and,
new
and,
clothes.
And it's that money thing with Spurs, the Spurs players, which
yep.
everyone's aware of, and they could be lured elsewhere.
It
like,
sounds like we're slagging Spurs off. I don't mean
I don't know,
to
Carl
it.
Walker, you know, when you go out and get the money you think you deserve, that's when
yep.
it gets dangerous, and that mindset is
well, look at how much Carl Walker got
criticised.
It was talked about on this podcast previously that Danny Rose and Kyle Walker may not be as good as they seemed. They just suited the Spurs system and the
yeah.
way that they play. Now,
well,
Kyle
Walker
has dispelled that because Kyle Walker has been exceptional.
Do you hate him a bit less now?
I always liked Kyle Walker. I did.
Yeah.
I've always liked Kyle Walker as a player. I thought he's a good fullback. I think he's a progressive fullback. He's a very modern fullback.
He is, yeah.
Because you have to be a winger now to be a fullback. You don't have to tackle as much as a fullback as you need to overlap.
Yeah.
But I do think now that you've got the money issue with Spurs. We all know that Jonjo Shelvey is paid more than Dembele. We all know that Jonjo Shelvey is paid 10 grand less a week than Dele Alli. It's
that is ridiculous.
Jamie Vardy's paid more than Harry Kane.
Yeah.
It's we know these things. Now, there are bonuses, and that's where Spurs come in. But the fact is that they're underpaid when you take into account the market value of players.
Yeah.
Of that, Harry Kane could treble his wages, if not quadruple them, with one transfer. Now, he says he wants to be a one-club man. He wants to stay at Spurs his entire career, and fair play to him. But you have to win trophies. Now, again, I've done it before, and people have criticised me for
it. Easy, isn't it, surely? Just win some trophies, yeah?
Yeah, exactly. But you have to.
And if you win a trophy, oh, it's only the Carabao Cup. Whatever, it's not a real thing.
Well, there's two trains of thought on a certain Premier League icon. Alan Shearer. Now, he got a lot of records because he scored all those goals. He was undoubtedly a fantastic player.
It is.
However, well, Alan Shearer would... My argument has always been Alan Shearer would be classed as a better player, be held in higher recognition on a world stage, not just the stage in Britain, if he had signed for Manchester United. Because if he had signed for Manchester United, he would be retired now with a load of Premier League winners' medals. He's got one with Blackburn Rovers. Now, Harry Kane, as amazing as he is, he's an extreme... I still stand by. I'm not getting into it. I still stand by. People who class Harry Kane in the same category as Messi and Ronaldo have got something wrong, because he's not as talented as them.
Who does that?
He's a very good... lot of players.
Really?
Lot of people. He's now being classed... Yeah. He's not as talented as those.
He's just
as
a smart
footballer.
He's just a smart forward.
He's a smart forward, and he scores a lot of goals. However, Christian Eriksen has got more talent in one foot.
Son.
Yeah.
Amazing.
Son, exactly. This
underground awesome.
And again,
player.
That's not me slagging off.
Sounds
Harry
like you're
Kane.
Slagging off Spurs.
I know it does. I'm
sounds
gonna
like
get
you,
hate
sounds
mail.
Like you, sounds like
it's
you,
me
sounds
playing
like you're
it. It's
doing
me
that.
Thinking of all the Arsenal fans. But it's Harry Kane, in my opinion, if he's to go down as someone who was a world-level footballer, world-class footballer, at the highest possible level, then he also has to be winning trophies.
And look, he's trying.
He's trying his best.
Poch is trying his best. It's a progressive thing.
But I just think that...
It's an interesting project, which I think there's only so much time.
If Man United had the same level...
It's on coming for Poch.
And
he
results.
He was content with... You would go, right?
Yeah.
Because he's done the stepping stone thing, which Marco Silva wishes he could have done, sort of thing.
Yeah. Pochettino, the next level now is...
But he seems content in his work, and he's focused on that.
He'll go abroad, I think.
Like, it's always touted as, like, the next Real Madrid coach and this, that, and the
other. But, yeah. But, no, so, yeah, that's our...
So, it's quantifiable in terms of that, like you said, with the expectation.
I'd just quite like to see everyone... Arsenal and Man United. Obviously, we're using Arsenal and Man United because they're our clubs. Arsenal and Man United are held to a higher level of expectation, and therefore,
at
the end of the day, Spurs.
I just don't get the levels.
Off the pace, and they're well off the pace they set last year. They're not as good.
I'm very confused with the levels of how success is actually shown.
Yeah,
especially when it comes to. Like the ratings and stuff, and like I said it last week, and I said it all the time, Arsenal fans, be careful what you wish for. At the end of this, I'm still Arsene Wenger. Wenger, I like you. I appreciate that. And like I said, if it comes to the end of the season, it's not renewed. Whatever, like I can deal with that. There should be a massive gratuity for him though.
Yeah.
There should be something for what he's given, which he doesn't get enough credit. He's not going to get enough credit. He never will because of the... because of that. So I'm very much an Arsene Wenger. I like you. I'll have a glass of wine with you.
I'm going to throw my name into it as well.
Yeah. The
good thing with... Well, I'd like to sort of just briefly about Arsenal, because as we did the running order and we wrote it all down this week, these things are planned, believe it or not. they're running up. Well, I see a lot of Arsenal fans. There was a conversation that I heard, which was, it was online, it wasn't like next door to me or anything, but people were discussing whether or not actually Arsenal winning was good for Arsenal fans, because it could mean that Wenger would stay at the club for long. And I was like, And the argument was basically, one person was saying, I think the quicker you get Arsene Wenger out of the club, the better for the club as a whole. And then the other one, who happened to be an Arsenal fan, was like, well, I'm never going to agree to that, because your club winning football matches is never going to be a bad thing. You'll always want your club to win football matches.
Yes.
Even if that meant that Wenger stays on for another season, which I don't think anybody thinks he should. I think Arsene Wenger, I think this should be his last season. But
again, let me go. What they wish for. Like, I hope it would be a smooth transition and there would be respect shown.
If he goes and Ancelotti comes in.
We're big fans of Carlo.
We do like Uncle
we
Carlo.
We do enjoy Carlo.
We do enjoy
but
him.
Look, there's no slight against the man that is Arsene Wenger. And like, there should be some consideration to what he's brought, and people should be careful what they wish for, because I think it's just one of those stable clubs who have been consistently at the top for some time.
Yeah.
And there's probably the toughest time because of all this negativity, and it's just understanding it is the ebb and flow of football. That is it. Your club wins, it loses, you want it more. Obviously, everyone wants that from a club.
Mm-hmm.
Like, look at Cardiff City now, our home team.
Yeah, Cardiff City.
Like, last year, they were a shambles.
They won again last night, Brentford.
Sir Warnock came into
play.
Do you
know what the odds on them getting promoted this season were?
Slim to none. Because of last
season. 25-1.
That's incredible.
They were, I've got to get this right now, they were higher odds. You could get better odds on Forest getting promoted.
Amazing.
Than Cardiff. Yeah. Now, Cardiff are second. They're 4 points above Villa, which is key.
We noticed a turnaround like last week, didn't we? Of people, actually pundits and all the English.
So Sky Sports
all
News
the
main
English
page.
Guys. Yeah.
Sky Sports News main page, Cardiff City.
Yeah. Now people are starting
Warnock's
to take
the
a
promotion
seat.
King.
He's great and he's got good contacts. But it's the first time last week that I've noticed and recognised that people are actually taking Cardiff City seriously right now. And I think it's lovely.
How many games are left now?
Like nine?
Eight, maybe, yeah.
Eight, nine.
Because they played last night, didn't they?
Point,
they beat Brentford.
My point being, I used to go down to Cardiff City. I used to see that when it was really awful, you know, the Ole Gunnar mix over between then. Last season, Warnock came in, stabilised, and now he's put this together. It's incredible. And it's incredible the turnover that the consideration of that's what happens in football.
Yeah.
When you've got an ethos and a project is working, it's fantastic to see the energy. When it's not, Sunderland struggle. And it's so interesting to see that finite balance. And it just goes and fits, it just sways a lot. And I like Arsenal, very privileged to be at the top and just have those sways. And it could be not considered good enough, but it's one of those things in football you have to expect.
Mm-hmm.
But it just does football no good when there's negativity, and like whoever's going to be the next target. I remember sitting there like when we first started this, and everyone was slagging off Liverpool for always bottling it.
Yeah, people forget that, don't they?
Everyone forgets about it. Because
it's been interesting watching the progression of football throughout while we've been doing nearly a season
for
the podcast.
But we are fully aware how fickle football and football fans are. We are completely aware of that, and it's just nonsense. But it gives us a chance to ramble and rant and rave, and it gives pundits, especially pundits, a chance to actually chip in and make some money and to say controversial things or other things. Jamie Carragher, like, it's just these type of things which always kick up, and it's because of that which makes rambling so much fun. And there's going to be some way out there opinions, but who are we to say? Well, it's like off another person's opinion.
Yeah, exactly.
When
exactly.
it comes to it.
Talking about Carragher, we should probably bring him up.
We shall briefly, because
we should briefly.
We're in Team Carragher with this, because it's been outrageous.
Can I add an asterisk to that? Can
yes.
I add an amendment? Right. My personal thoughts, the first thing I thought
I think
of,
you nailed it, so I think you should round that up.
My initial thoughts were,
it's lovely.
That is a ridiculous thing to have done. What the hell are you doing?
Because you saw the headline, you saw the quick thing.
Yeah,
you
all
saw
I saw
pictures.
Was it flashed up like,
because
you know,
you're a Daily Mail
reader. My best, oi. I am not. I'm adding it. I am not a Daily Mail reader. All right. Genuinely, the Daily Mail. I can't swear. I'm not allowed to swear. But no, I'm not a Daily Mail reader. That's worse than when you made an Adam Johnson. That. Okay.
I didn't
right.
know such thing.
No. Okay.
Slander.
That has never happened. It's worse than I said. Barcelona didn't pay tax. Oh.
Allegedly.
Right. Well, my first thoughts were, because I saw the headline come up, Jamie Carragher spits at fan. I was like, what's he done that for? That's ludicrous. Then I saw it was a film, and I thought, right, so he's being filmed doing it. He knows he's on camera. What?
I don't know if he knew.
What is this about? We may not have, but initially the first thing you think of is he's been filmed doing it. And then I saw the pictures, the stills from it, and it looks like he's looking at the camera. So I'm like, right, you must know he's on camera. So initially I was not pro Carragher at all. I was like, this is ridiculous.
And that's how it was
Something
spun.
Needs to happen. Because that's how it was spun.
Yeah.
But then when you get into the story a bit more, I then still was anti-Carragher, but I was also anti the guy filming it. Because what is a grown man doing driving down a road with a mobile phone in his hand, filming himself, abusing another? These men
He's
are both
driving with a 14
right,
year old
these
daughter.
Men are both over 40 years old, and they are driving down a road having an argument in a, like, what? I just can't.
Oh dear. Oh, what's he done there?
Yeah, I couldn't
oh,
work it
dear.
Out.
Like the whole goading thing.
So now, because the media have immediately, it's just all been Carragher. Now, I put up on my Twitter the other day, and it was a genuine question, and I posted
it
as
a genuine
question.
No, I was going to say, yeah, absolutely.
Has the guy filming it been arrested? Because if you were driving your car, if you came to get me
for
this...
Have you ever heard anyone be arrested on their phone or get fined? Anyone you know, anyone at all?
I know of one person.
In a space of what? 5 years?
A long time, yeah. But if you were, if you filmed yourself on the phone and you were just messing around with me, yeah, say, on your phone, but you were using it while driving and it went viral, you'd get a knock on your door.
Yeah.
Now, nothing's been met. This guy, it is illegal. What he did is illegal. So I'm assuming he's been charged, because he should be charged. Now, when you add into the fact that he is driving, using a mobile phone, abusing another 40-year-old man, while his 14-year-old daughter is watching it, like, honestly, mate, honestly, he should have had to apply for a license before being able to have children.
And what did you
children.
Say? The most sensical thing that's come about is that 14-year-old girl who...
The only person who comes out of this entire situation with any credit is the 14-year-old, and bless her heart, the 14-year-old girl who is in the middle of two middle-aged men having a row about a football game, and she's in the middle of it going, Dad, just stop. Just stop. Like,
and
it broke
come
my heart.
Out yesterday saying, I don't want him to lose his job.
She's come out now saying, I don't want him to lose his job. He said sorry. I accept his apology. I just want to move on.
It's like
she doesn't want to be involved in this. Her idiot father has dragged her into this. It's
like
unbelievable.
The media
There's
spun
no
it
credit.
Like he's a sexual predator or something like that. Or he's been caught with some horrificness.
You would assume, just based on a lot of the headlines, if you redacted the spat out a window, if you redacted that, you would assume he punched her.
Yeah. Or did something.
Now, I'm not saying that what he did wasn't reprehensible
and
was hot.
Instantly apologised for.
Yeah, he
they
apologized.
Suspended him. He instantly.
It makes me wonder how quickly he would have apologised if there wasn't video evidence, but that's another.
Look,
that's
not
neither here nor there.
Because he's been brought into this media absolute circus for doing this, and he's. Like, it was a quick thing, and the interviewer was just like, do you regret what you've done? Like, straight away. And you know what I mean? It's like being interviewed by Bashir, for Christ's sake.
Do you think you should get sacked? It was. I felt like,
I thought
he was Michael Jackson.
Yeah.
And Bashir there talking about
how many children in the bed?
Yeah.
Like, it's just above and beyond what was necessary for that. And it just shows you how much things can be blown up to force Carragher into, like, okay, I'm here to apologise. Okay, wheel him out. We've got him. Put the lights on him. This is going on. Big hit. Boom.
The worst part about it was when he arrived at Euston Station in London and he was met by a media scrum. And there was one journalist. Now, if you've watched the video, they'll know who it is, who I'm talking about. You'll all know who I'm talking about. There was one guy and he was asking Jamie Carragher questions with the most smug look on his face I've ever seen any person do. And he was like, how are you? Have you apologised? And he was smiling and he was
so glad I'm not famous.
I was watching that and I was just thinking, do you know what, Jamie, you're already in trouble, mate. You might as well hit him. Because the look on his face, yeah, just look at him and get those Dilophosaurus lips working. It's just, but like I said, I'm not defending what Carragher said.
Not doing that, and we're just not putting the media on trial because that's just pointless.
Yeah, I'm not doing any of that. All I'm simply saying is that what has been forgotten in all of this is that not all heroes wear capes. And that 14-year-old girl deserves an absolute medal. Sense. She spoke the most sense out of anyone. There's two middle-aged men, and there's a 14-year-old girl in the middle.
Love that. And then a hurricane of just ridiculousness in the middle.
She doesn't care. She just wants to get... And when her dad goes to film her, and she pushes the phone away, Dad, just stop it. Dad, stop
it. Oh, dear. Oh, dear.
Yeah,
ooh,
and then he carries
on.
Oh, Jamie Carragher spitting at my 14-year-old. It's like, oh, mate, get a life.
Right, we'll
get
kill her
a life.
You've listened to all the Joey Barton.
I'm listening to the Tony Bellew one. Now,
okay,
which is
that
the
was
most,
a new one. Yeah,
that was this morning.
Yeah,
I started.
Yeah,
that
yeah, yeah. I saw it this morning. Still liking it.
I'm liking
it. He does try and bring his ego attachment is underlined in all of it, doesn't it? Whoever he's speaking to, so, well, you know, with me, and I've got a bad reputation, or when I've been going through it, and this, that, and the other.
Well, yeah, because Joey Barton has sold the last 10 years
and
of his life on his reputation.
It's great that he's thinking now about his life after football. I understand how passionate he is about football. Mm-hmm. I totally get that. And then one thing he is open about, which is a common topic of mine to mention, which is gambling. And when he mentions like how insane his gambling addiction was. He knew it was wrong. He knew it. He just see how long he could push it. And now, like after 10 years or whatever, he's just been suspended now. A little bit of a ban, which is on his game, but a very integral part of his career. And now he's just thinking about what to do after football, basically. And he's going to be coming back. But the thing that resonates with me is that how easy it is for young professionals or professionals or anyone to get involved in a gambling like spiral. Like he didn't realize how much he was actually gambling until he had a little bit of a flutter, and he thinks because of his rebellious nature, he was just thinking that it's because no one was telling him to stop, and he knew it was wrong. That's what buzzed him to keep going on. He's like, now I've got a gambling ban. I'm not interested. It's just a regimented part of his routine, like day, like, and he's struggling for routine now. That's what he wants actively.
Yeah,
he misses that, and he
does.
Just doesn't know what to do.
You need. It's the way we've spoken around it before with the gambling thing of, but it's how it is. It's the certain personalities. People will disagree. And they can disagree as much as they want. It's a fact. There is addiction is not something that someone wakes up and says, "Do you know what? I'm going to become addicted to that." It's not a choice. It's chemical. It's a chemical imbalance. It's like depression. And
yeah.
I'm not comparing. That sounds like I'm comparing that. It's not. But what I'm saying is, it is a my point of my comparison there was based on people. Just there are still people in this world who, when someone says I'm depressed, they go, "Oh, well, cheer up then." Well, it's a chemical imbalance. Listen, it's chemical imbalance. It's not. It's a medical complaint. It's like saying I've broken my leg. Would you walk on it? It's not comparable. You know,
yeah.
it's depression, and that's what and addiction is
deeper.
The same. Addiction
yeah.
is the same. Now, I won't go into it in too much detail, but speaking from my personal experience, there is, I know, as a, I'm now well aware in my early to mid 30s, that I cannot.
Joe Rogan says that's when you start understanding.
Yeah, well, I'm now coming into mid 30s very fast, and I now realise and adjust behaviour based on, I know that I have an extremely addictive personality, and I learned that in a very harsh way, but I learned it. And I know I can't do certain things. Now, I've gambled previously. I've now closed all my accounts. Because, not because I was addicted to the gambling or I was getting addicted to it. However, there are certain triggers which I have now recognised in my behaviour and in my life. That when they happen, I then sit and go, right, okay, that's a trigger. I know that feeling. I've had that feeling before. I know where it led me before, and I adjust it. Now that is coming from someone who has been an addict before, to know that those feelings just triggered in me very briefly when it comes to gambling, and then I turn on any football match and it's sponsored by gambling companies.
Well, it's just it's everywhere.
Yeah,
I think it's on.
It's like, wondering.
But I'm aware that if people want to do it, that's fine.
We're not preaching. It's just an interesting risk.
Yeah, I'm just keen on that. But I like how open Joey is when it comes to that.
Yeah, it is interesting. Like again, we've said it before. If you haven't watched any of the Barton episodes, I would personally recommend the I can't remember his name, the England coach.
Oh, the Clive Woodward.
Yeah, I would personally recommend that one. I thought that was fascinating.
Yeah. I like them all. I like the psychologist.
But yeah, the psychologist one was very good. Yeah. But I did think the Woodward one was good because I'm not the biggest rugby fan.
Do you know what I was impressed with? Cipriani one.
I haven't listened to all of it yet. I've got my own opinions on stuff with Cipriani.
Because of the therapy that he's had.
Yeah, well, because of that mentality. It is worth watching. It is worth watching. On that, I want to move to a different question.
Let's do it.
Jack Crosswell, on Twitter, asked us ahead of the England World Cup squad announcement, which is tomorrow, I believe. Tomorrow, he just said, "Where have all England centre backs gone?"
What do you mean? Where have they gone?
Well, if you look at, I think he's got a point in that.
Phil Jones, Chris Morning.
Well, right, two out of the three there. I wouldn't. I think he's saying they used to have Rio Ferdinand. Again, he's got a point. Right, let's break England down for a little bit if we can.
Okay, if we have
I know.
To, sure.
Okay, you've got, I would argue,
J-Bucks.
Harry Kane, Raheem Sterling and Marcus Rashford is potentially up there with the best front three at that World Cup.
What?
I think they've got, they look at goals they've scored and performances this season.
Out of the teams that they'll be
just
there.
Just those three.
The teams that'll be there.
Yeah.
You think that's the strongest three?
No. I didn't say that's the strongest. I said I was up there.
You're full of nonsense.
They've
whimsy.
Scored more goals than any
you're
other
just being
front
controversial
three in the World Cup.
For sake of it.
No, I'm not.
Totally are.
Right, Harry Kane.
I don't think you actually believe that statement.
No, I do. I think Argentina's
you're a
better.
Harry Kane fan?
As a goal scorer, yeah.
Right.
I'm just saying that he's not as talented as Lionel Messi.
Right.
That's all I said.
Yeah.
My argument is England have got a very strong front three currently. If they play Rashford, Sterling, and Harry Kane, that's a strong front three. Argue against those three's performances this season.
It's just a bizarre thing to really call me off.
Argue against those three. Good,
it's
I'm glad this got you off.
I just didn't expect that.
Okay.
No.
But their back line
is
shocking.
Right, okay. Okay.
But their fullbacks are actually, they've got quite a good set of fullbacks at the minute. They're not bad, you know, for England, if you go over the history of it, they haven't got that bad a set of fullbacks. They've got Walker.
Yeah.
They've got Trippier. They've got some good, talented players.
Trippier. Really?
Yeah. My basic point is if you talk about the players that are in that England squad, would you class Phil Jones, Chris Smalling and Cahill as the strongest members of that squad?
I can't see anyone stronger at the moment.
No, but they're not. This is his point.
Yeah.
There is no one stronger,
mm-hmm.
but that doesn't mean that they're strong. That simply means they're the strongest that they have, but they're very, very weak options.
Yeah.
And this is what he's getting to. What I'm getting to, probably in a roundabout way, is that we all know who's going to play up front for England if he's fit. We all know who's going to play right wing for England if he's fit. We all know better centre back.
Do you think Rashford would start?
I think he should. I really do think he should. Who else would start?
Well, I could say Lingard.
Yeah, I think based on, I just think that Harry Kane with two lightning fast wingers either side of him, both of who've got an eye for goal, because Raheem Sterling has, again,
Raheem.
right, okay, let's break it down into, let's go
Raheem's had
all,
a phenomenal
yeah,
season.
okay, let's
Phenomenal.
all go stats bomb for a little bit,
Okay.
yeah? Raheem Sterling is the highest
Top of his
performing
game. Top of his game.
winger
Yeah.
in world football, not just England, world football, based on assists and goals and XG, and we can bring all of
Yeah.
this into it. But if we go stats bomb on this,
Yeah.
he has been performing extremely well. Chelsea are playing, mate.
Yeah, all right. I don't agree with you, but yeah, I like with Sterling, absolutely, right? With Kane is Kane. He still think he's hit miss for England.
Yeah, but he has. They have been performing. What I mean is, from a stats bomb point of view,
We know what's gonna happen with England already.
we know what's going to happen with
You know when
England.
they're gonna go out. I don't even like. That's one of the reasons why we were saying we hate the World Cup for this reason. Like I'm interested in the other aspect of the World Cup, which would probably make me want to go to Russia to see it if we ever get to, if we get the funding we need from
Yeah,
our
we just need some
sponsors.
funding to get to Russia.
I think our sponsors that we're just talking to a few people at the moment to see if that's a possibility, see if we can do that on like a nightly basis as a roundup. But I don't know. Well, that's another aspect. But it's just the same old thing. But I'm very intrigued about the Russia thing.
Yeah, it's gonna be. It isn't.
Because
It's.
there'll be a lot going on in that mix.
There's a lot going on, especially. Do you
Yeah.
know what won't be going on?
Neymar.
I guarantee. Yeah, right. I guarantee you that there won't be any. There won't be any England fans clashing with Russian police. That won't happen, will it? There's no way that's gonna happen.
Definitely not, and there'll be no hooliganism.
No, there'll be none of that.
There'll be a lack of
You
that.
know, and all the Russian delegates getting thrown out of the country today. That won't.
I think he'll be a. I think that'll make it, to be honest with you. I think he'll be absolutely fine with that.
So that'll be part two.
Yeah. I'll just switch this off.
No, you can't. You have to leave it open or it will not save.
Right. He'll be there. Yeah, fair enough then. That's fine. Okay, so we just opened up a little English can of worms there.
Yeah, right.
Yeah.
Should we,
Bit of fantasy.
yeah, let's round
Can
it
I
up with some fantasy.
tell you a top tip
Yeah.
for listeners as well? If you've got a free hit, use it this week.
Yeah, it's the week
This
to
is the
use
week to
it.
use your free hit.
Free hit is there for a week like this. If you play fantasy football, yeah, use the free hit. I haven't,
You
but I've got
haven't?
a plan.
Do you
I
wanna
haven't got it left. I've already used my free hit.
enlighten us? You get.
I'm using my wild card.
Yeah. That's making it tricky, isn't it?
It's not because I've already planned ahead for this week. So I already had.
Right, okay, so you used it in the run up to this.
I knew this week was coming 6 weeks ago.
Wow.
So I had, yeah, I know. So I had,
That's
I'm
full
just
on
flicking
prep.
through and I saw it. So I've already got a Huddersfield defender in.
That's what I've done. I've got the big three. Dun dun dun.
Yeah. Is that your free hit played?
Yeah. And I'm gonna tweak it around a little
Yeah,
bit. So
I've
yeah.
got mine planned, but
Smash a free hit on this week. Can you use your bench boost with a free hit or not?
no, you're gonna need one chip.
No. One chip.
Yeah.
Okay, so yeah, that's what I've done. Anyway, I've free hit it to give myself maximums. This will be the time now where you can potentially get up and running if get back into it because
Yeah, it's the
people
week to make up some ground.
yeah, I
It
think so.
definitely is.
I haven't triple captain yet either.
I'm triple captained, but I'm playing my second wild card. I haven't played bench boost, that'll come in,
Yeah,
and then I'm going to triple captain shortly. But I know
so
when I'm going to play that.
I've still got my wild card. I'm using my free hit. That's the only one I've used. I've got everything.
Yeah, no, I'm playing wild card
I'm
now.
playing wild card.
I think we're done.
I think so. Yeah. Should we begin with FIFA,
Yeah,
and
let's have
have
a
a
game
bit
of
more of a
FIFA.
ramble? We'll probably have a little bit of an extra FIFA ramble,
Yeah, we'll
just
have a little bit of
casually.
a ramble. If you're interested now when you're watching live, head over to Twitch, search FIFA Ramble on Twitch.
Do some twitching.
Yeah, and we'll jump on Twitch.
Yeah.
We'll play some FIFA on Twitch. Also, We're doing a career mode. We've got two Twitch channels. Go on to the Calhoun Review on Twitch. If you like watching gaming, we've got a Twitch account. And we're doing a West Brom career mode over there. It's going really well. So, yeah, head over there.
Some are calling them the new Pards.
Yeah, new Pards. I'm trying to banish the memory of Pards forever. And also, as it goes without saying, follow at the FIFA Ramble on Twitter and on Instagram. And if you're listening to this on Facebook and not Anchor, download Anchor and listen to it. It's a great app.
Yeah, it's cool.
It is good.
Yeah. So give that a go. Right, thanks Facebookers.
Thanks very much.
Appreciate
it's been
it.
Enjoyable, and we will see you next week.
Goodbye.
Bye bye.
Right, still going on here. That's part two of that.
Thanks very much, Anchor. This is just you and this is just us now.
Yeah, got rid of everyone else.
Yeah, so we'll see you again next week. Thanks for listening.
Nice one.
But yeah, go follow us on Facebook as well.
Thanks very much.
Search the FIFA Ramble. Go follow us on Instagram at the FIFA Ramble, Twitter at the FIFA Ramble. You can go search us on YouTube. We've got two. We've got the FIFA Ramble and Calhoun Review.